Between January 1979 and May 1979, what happened was unimaginable massacre. Police was let on the island, women were raped, kids were killed, thrown into the river, men were shot at point blank range, and they were, pressure was put on them to leave the island, to go back to the undercurrent. There was pressure from the left-front government on the media owners to stop reporting on Marichjhapi. Though it, you know, you have to realize it's 1979, there was no social media. Media also was very limited. But it still baffles me how something that was so close to Kolkata could go on like this for a period of so many months without civil society rising in anger. It baffles me. The perpetrators of the violence made sure that this remains a lapse in memory, that you and I don't get to know about it, that it's not written about, it's not spoken about. It's even if some books come out, they are sort of quickly taken off shelves. If somebody wants to talk about it in a lecture circuit, somebody from the audience shuts him down. But it's very important that we remember such massacres and we sort of recount what happened and why. As nations grapple with refugee crisis, Marichjhapi should be retrieved from the dustbin of history. I work with India Today. I've just written a book called Blood Island. It's on an incident that happened almost 40 years ago. But you know, even now, as we look at the news, the relevance of this incident, this incident is relevant. Why do I say this? Because one of the hot topics in news in the recent past, in fact, for the past 2-3 days, has been the intolerance debate. 49 eminent citizens have written to the Prime Minister saying that there is intolerance in the country, there are lynchings in the name of Ram, and whether Jai Shri Ram has become a war cry. And I firmly believe that killings, lynchings, any killings, whether in the name of Ram, Rahim, Mao Zedong, should be so condemned, and it should not happen. But what happens when there is no debate? What happens when we are not told that something very gruesome has taken place? What happens when the perpetrators of that kind of massacre are themselves the agenda setters? What happens when they're the history writers? What happens when they're the talk circuit crowd? What happens when you and I don't get to know about this? My book, Blood Island, An Oral History of the Marichjhapi Massacre, is about one such event. Like I said, it happened 40 years ago in an island in Sundarbans, which is around 75 kilometers east of Kolkata. It's a very interesting island. It's an archipelago. There's forest, there's land, there's rivers meeting sea. It's a cluster of 104 islands, of which roughly around 54 islands have human habitation. In one of those islands called Marichjhapi, around 5,000 to 10,000 people, if you believe the survivors of the massacre, were butchered. The official figures say that less than 10 people were killed. So why this vast difference? This vast difference is because, like I said, the perpetrators of the violence made sure that this remains a lapse in memory, that you and I don't get to know about it, that it's not written about, it's not spoken about. It's even if some books come out, they are sort of quickly taken off shelves. If somebody wants to talk about it in a lecture circuit, somebody from the audience shuts him down. But it's very important that we remember such massacres and we sort of recount what happened and why. So let me go back to the beginning. Around when India became an independent country. It also saw partition, which till today remains a huge scar. Millions of Hindus moved from what is now Pakistan to India, and vice versa. Millions of Muslims moved the other way. In what was then East Pakistan, the first flux of refugees that came in to Bengal were mostly the upper caste Hindus. The lower caste Hindus, whom we roughly call Dalits, they stayed back. They stayed back because they were very attached to the land. and to the rivers. They were into fishing and they were into farming, and they thought that they were victims of the caste discrimination by the upper caste Hindus, as were their fellow Muslims, who because of their religion were also kept apart from the mainstream. So they thought that we don't really need to fear the Muslims in this new land. They're our brothers, because they were fellow tillers, they were fellow fishermen. So we don't need to move with the upper caste Hindus. This is our land, we will stay here. But the experience turned out to be anything but welcoming. Riots continued, and through the 40s, late 40s, the 50s, the 60s, you know, waves of refugees started coming to Bengal, huge waves. Mostly, as I said, the lower caste Hindu refugees. Now, it was very difficult for the West Bengal government at that time to absorb all of them. So they wrote to the center saying, what do we do with so many people? We don't have the resources to absorb them. So the center said, look, there's a space called the Dandakarand Development Authority. There's an authority called the Dandakarand Development Authority, and there's a space in what is modern day Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, cutting into Maharashtra, a bit of Orissa, where there are these temporary refugee camps, and those refugees can be sent here and they can be made to work. They can be made to till the land, they can be made to work for construction of roads. So you send them here. So while these people were coming, it was a Congress government in Bengal at that time. The left, the CPIM most prominently, they said that this is a very wrong thing that's happening. These are our brothers and sisters. They have come from Bangladesh and they should be absorbed within West Bengal. And they promised these refugees, you know, if a day comes when we come to power, we will make sure that you are brought back from Dandakaran and you are rehabilitated in West Bengal. The refugees till today, the people who survived, they remember those promises. Even Jyoti Basu, who later became the chief minister of West Bengal, he reportedly addressed refugee gatherings and said, look, I promise you, you would be brought back to West Bengal. Now, time passed. These refugees were sent to the Dandakaran. They tried to adapt to the new land, new people. It was difficult. For most of them, it was a new language. The climatic conditions were not favorable. And they dreamt of going back to Bengal, settling there somewhere. Finally, in 1977, the left came to power in Bengal. And they sent a memorandum to the left-run government in Bengal saying that, you know, you promised we would be brought back. So please, this is the time. We have been waiting. We have saved up some money. We want to come back to West Bengal. There was no answer. They waited. Finally, they located an island in the Sundarbans where there was no habitation, and they decided this is a place where they can go and settle down and make it home. So waves of refugees came from all over the Dandakaran. They came to Bengal and they were stopped at the railway station and they were forced back into trains, most of them, that no, you have to go back to where you came from. But some of them slipped through. And they, after a very arduous trek, it's a very difficult terrain to go. Even now, if you want to go to this particular island from Kolkata, you'll find it very difficult if you don't know the way. Finally, they reached this island, Marichjhapi, and over a period of 6 to 8 months, amazingly, they transformed this island. They sort of made roads, they built huts, they had a school, they had a medical center, there was a well. There was a boat manufacturing unit. They started farming. They started fishing. And they said that, you know, we would sort of, the fish we catch, we are going to go and sell it at lower price in the adjoining markets. And that's how we are going to sustain ourselves. They started a boat manufacturing unit. They would build boats. You need small boats to travel in Sundarbans from one island to the other. The West Bengal government was alarmed. They said, oh, this is not what's supposed to be. So they said, look, this can't be, you have to go back to the Dandakaran. These guys were adamant. They said, no, we are not going. What they did was, they sent a few delegations to talk to them, and when they were sent back saying, no, nothing doing, we are not going back, they started an economic blockade. Now, I've gone to this place, this island, there's an island called Kumirmari, and in Marichjhapi itself, there was a problem that you had no drinking water. So they would take these small boats and go to Kumirmari with pots, fill them up with drinking water, come back. River water was saline. So they had to go to Kumirmari to get water. So police launches surrounded this island. And there was a blockade for around 15 days where these boats, these islanders could not take the boats to go to Kumirmari. 15 days without water, food supplies. They resorted to eating grass, eating shrubs, drinking saline water. Kids died of dysentery. This case, there's a gentleman, Shakko Sen, who's a lawyer. He represented them, took their case to court. The court ordered, no, this can't happen. This is illegal. This kind of economic blockade on this bunch of refugees is illegal. You can't do this. So the blockade was lifted. By that time, lots of people had died, especially children. This was January 1979. Between January 1979 and May 1979, what happened was unimaginable massacre. Police was let on the island. Women were raped. Kids were killed, thrown into the river. Men were shot at point blank range. And they were, pressure was put on them to leave the island, to go back to the undercurrent. The Bengali press reported it sporadically, but the report stopped. People say, and I have spoken to senior journalists, that there was pressure from the left-front government on the media owners to stop reporting on Marichjhapi. Though it, you know, you have to realize it's 1979, there was no social media. Media also was very limited. But it still baffles me how something that was so close to Kolkata could go on like this for a period of so many months without civil society rising in anger. It baffles me. But it so happened that the massacres continued. Finally, in May 1979, in the middle of the night, policemen swooped into the island and they torched around 6,000 huts. And the next morning, people died in the fire. Next morning, the remaining refugees were packed into police launches, taken to mainland, and from there, they were packed off to the undercurrent. Few of the refugees escaped. They escaped not only on that night, they had sort of left the island before also when the atrocities started. And they hid from the police and made home in various parts of West Bengal. What I did was, what this book is about is tracking those refugees and listening to those voices. It is very difficult to recollect an incident that happened so many years ago, exactly 40 years ago, and to pinpoint exactly how many people were killed or what happened. I thought when I approached the subject that the best way to do it is to go to those on whom such atrocities were done, to go to the people themselves. And my travel took me to Sundarbans, to various places of Bengal, to Madhya Pradesh, because it was part of the Undercurrent Development Authority once, to Chhattisgarh, outside Raipur Airport. There's an area, it's still called Mana Camp. Mana Camp was one of the most important camps of the Undercurrent. And if you go to Mana Camp, it's a fairly large area. If you go to Mana Camp, you will still find that almost all the inhabitants of Mana Camp are Bengali refugees. And many of them, if you talk to them, had made the trek from Bengal to the Undercurrent, from the Undercurrent back to Bengal, to Sundarbans, and forced back. And some of them still remember. It's a memory too tragic for them to recollect. But my travels had taken me to Raipur, and I have spoken to them and have penned this book. Now, I was 5 years old at that time. How did I come to this book? Why am I recollecting the story of Marichjhapi? I am recollecting the story of Marichjhapi because Marichjhapi is, funnily enough, my earliest memory. My father, who was a university professor, he happened to be among a bunch of poets, professors, public intellectuals who had at that time gone to the island, spoken to the refugees and offered them monetary aid. They could not stop the massacre, and eventually they were also stopped from going into the island anymore. He knew the story. And when the massacre was taking place, one of the refugee leaders, one of the most prominent personalities from that island, a guy called Rongolal Goldar, he escaped the police and he asked my father requested my father if he could keep his teenage daughter in our house while he is hiding from the police and trying to find a safe place for themselves. And his daughter, Mana Goldar, she's a chapter in the book, came to my house and was introduced to me as a distant cousin. I was 5 years old, Mana was 15, 16. And the bedtime stories in my childhood were stories of Marichjhapi. I was too young to understand rape, too young to understand murder also. But there were stories of great adventure of a very determined group of women and men making that long trek from East Pakistan, which is today Bangladesh, to Bengal, being sent to transit camps in Dandakaran, spending years there, coming to Sundarbans, setting up habitation there, and being forced back. It was an amazing story, and Mana used to tell me in fragments. And that was my first memory. When I became a journalist years later, Mana left within a year. By that time, her father had found a place to stay. They had built a house. And when I started my journalism career in Kolkata as a freelance journalist for Hindustan Times, I sort of was drawn towards what is generally known as human interest stories. And I met a gentleman called Jyotirmoy Mondol. Jyotirmoy Mondol is another chapter in the book. He's a very interesting guy. He saves witches. He goes to these far-flung villages, tribal villages, and he rehabilitates women who have become widows and who are branded witches because their in-laws or their sort of want, or the villagers want to take away their land. So he rehabilitates them, he saves them. And we became fast friends because he was a source of many of my stories. I traveled with him. And one day over a cup of chai in the afternoon, Jyotirmoy started talking. And I started talking about the history of the left, the violence of the left down the ages. And I asked him that, I remembered Marichjhapi, and I asked him that, do you know something called Marichjhapi Massacre? And his face turned white. And after a while, he told me that I was in Marichjhapi. I am a survivor. That was my second instance where my father really did not speak to me till now about Marichjhapi. But Mana and then Jyotirmoy Mondol. And then it interested me to sort of examine the subject more. I was in Bhopal for the past 2.5 years. I was editing a newspaper. I had decided on the book by then, and I was doing my research. I was trying to find out where I will find more survivors and whether sort of I can put together a book which is a survivor account on the incident. And I was discussing the book one day, and one of the brightest reporters in my team suddenly said, sir, I know this story. So I said, how do you know this story? You were not even born then. And her name is Mokapati Purnima. I said, you're not even a Bengali. How are you related to Marichjhapi? And she said, well, my father is from Andhra Pradesh, but my mother is a Bengali. And my mother is a Bengali refugee. And my mother was in Marichjhapi. And I asked her that if I can meet her mother. And she accepted, and I met that person. And she told me that you should not just speak to me, but you should travel 5 kilometers out of Bhopal. And you will find that there are 36 Bengali villages, five hours out of Bhopal. There are around 36 Bengali villages where the population, most of the population, remember Marichjhapi. So I made that trek, and I went there, and there are normal villages, and there are signboards in Bengali, in Hindi, sometimes in English. And it's fascinating to see so many Bengali villages in Madhya Pradesh. And I spent a day and a half there. And people just came up to me to talk about Marichjhapi. And grown men, men who are today, I saw a political leader there, local political leader, very tough guy. He's like a political toughy. And while talking, he broke down. He said, I had gone to wash my face in the river and I saw 3 dead babies floating in the river. He said, why are you here? I mean, you should not make me remember those days. And I said, I have to write this book, and I'm also invested in the story. It's also in a sense my story because I heard it when I was only 5. And he invited me to his house, and we spent hours just talking about the massacre that happened. So my endeavor in this book, you know, there's this person called Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak. She wrote a seminal essay called "Can the Subaltern Speak?" Her point was that the subaltern, the downtrodden, they don't speak. It's only people like you and me who appropriate their voices, who speak for them, you know, like the intolerance letter, we are speaking for people. Her point is that they are not allowed to speak. My endeavor in the book was to turn it into an oral history, to make those people remember Marichjhapi, and to record and write as honestly, as thoroughly I can, possibly can, what they're telling me, and not to interpret it. If you read the book, you will perhaps find some find some details that are not really adding up, because people are remembering. It's remembered history. People are remembering. So one person is remembering it a little differently from the other person in the next chapter. But I did not want to change that. I didn't want to edit it out. I thought, let them speak. There's an introduction to the book where I said that, you know, I have not, the only way to make sense of the massacre is to make the survivors of the massacre come together and to say what they have to say. And that has been the endeavor, and that's the book. 85-year-old Narayan Banerjee stays by a ditch with his 72-year-old wife Ashalata. Bishwas had led us to their mud hut. Vishwas is another person who accompanied me in my travel, where their grandchildren now jostle for space. He and his wife were amongst those who had made the long journey from Mana camp to Marichjhapi. They never left. I had typhoid, and so I had come to Kumirmari for treatment. When they evicted my Marichjhapi neighbors, Asha and I were right below their noses, but they had no clue. But he must have known what happened in those last few days. The rickety journeyman gasps for air with his mouth wide open. Scared, I hold his arm. Apni theek achen, are you okay? Baba, do not make me go back to the past. It is too painful, too painful. Banerjee reminds me of the futility of my search for answers to Marichjhapi. The whys and the hows and the whens are like fresh bullet wounds to the already dispossessed. 40 years have passed since the island was cleansed. What good could possibly come of my shuffling through the dog-eared pages of their collective memory? Yet it remains one of the only ways left to document the ambitious journey of a band of women and men who dared to look the state in the eye and paid a very heavy price for it. As nations grapple with refugee crisis, Marichjhapi should be retrieved from the dustbin of history. I want to touch briefly on the whys. You know, why did the left do what it did? What was the need for this kind of massacre? Why were women raped and kids thrown into the river? You know, after having spent almost 5 years on this book, I still do not have the answer. Marichjhapi has, funnily, while it has not been mainstreamed, you know, it has been spoken about, written about in university papers in Oxford and Cambridge. And a very interesting paper by Anu Jalias, Shim and Ross Malik, they have said that, you know, it's because of the inherent caste bias of the left-front government. It's a funny thing to say, caste bias of the left-front government, because the left always talks of a casteless, classless society. But their argument is that while they speak these things, most of the leaders of the political left were upper caste. And they get to fix about lower caste Hindus who defied them and settled in an island. So they argue that it's about a caste bias. I am not completely convinced after the book. I think it's a little more. You see, the left front government that came to power in West Bengal, it's a left front government. It's not just a CPM government. There are other left constituents. One of the constituents was a party called RSP, Revolutionary Socialist Party. Now this Sundarbans area was under the control of the RSP. So it's like a coalition government, only of left parties. Now, these refugees who settled in Marichjhapi, you started hating Jyoti Basu and the CPM because they had gone back on their word. But they were somewhat close to a gentleman, the gentleman from the Revolutionary Socialist Party, who were operating in that religion and who were also reportedly somewhat sympathetic to them. Now the CPM thought that, you know, these are just 1.5 lakh refugees, there are many more refugees. Suppose they start coming in mass into Bengal and start settling in Sundarban and other areas of Bengal. And when the election comes next time, they vote not for CPM but RSP, the balance within the left front will become a problem. The chance is that RSP, which is a junior member, you know, in the left front, will perhaps become a senior member. Imagine it's like a BJP and Shiv Sena in Maharashtra. Right. So it's the compulsion of coalition politics.
Deep, how do you view this event in let's say the present scenario when we talk
so much about the atrocities on Dalits from the upper caste, basically Dalits and Muslims, especially since the
BJP came to power in 2014. Yeah. Every day or the other, we hear about some caste-based violence and the leftist intellectuals, especially blaming the central government that it's an upper caste Brahminical party. But such an event being forgotten, how do you view this in the present day context when everyone is, see, every leftist especially seems to be bothered about lower caste but not even mentioning this, and no one taking, you know, the blame that okay, it was a leftist government which let this happen.
See, there's a narrative. I mean, it's a political question, so the answer has, I think, has to veer towards politics, but I think it's a narrative that they have set, that they speak for the voiceless, they speak for the powerless, they speak for the downtrodden, the Dalits and the Muslims. Marichjhapi stands as a mirror to that lie.
Yeah,
you know, so of course these are, I mean, like I said, any lynching, any instance of lynching, any killing should be condemned. Letters should be sent to the Prime Minister, why not? I mean, he's answerable. Letters should be sent not just by eminent citizens but by any citizen, you know, and even for one killing which should not happen. But it's also perhaps important to see who's sending the letter. I mean, when you were in power, done something so horrific and done everything in your power to hide that, right? I mean, when you talk about killing, it's a little funny.
It's funny.
I mean, it's hugely hypocritical. So yes, I mean, those concerns remain. I mean, if there are instances of violence, the state needs to take care that such things don't happen. But the guys who are raising questions, they also need to look at themselves right. More thoroughly.
Yeah, so my question was that, since like when you were doing R&D for your book, like we all know that the Marichjhapi incident was, the massacre was, they had to cover it up, right?
Yeah.
So there must be some sort of trail in the government machinery and also the like the police and all.
Yeah.
So did you approach them?
I spoke to the police, the SP, superintendent of police at that time, tried to speak to him. He didn't speak to me. He does not. People have tried to speak to him over the years.
Okay.
Omiyo Shamanto, he doesn't speak to people. He has written a piece for, I think, the Telegraph where he says that such thing didn't happen. It's a lie. It's an elaborate lie. Something I didn't mention in the book. I happened to meet his son through a common friend, not for the book. Generally, it so happened that I met his son who was in Delhi at that time. And when I got to know that he is that man's son, despite being a journalist, I thought that I will not speak to him because it was not the intention. But the common friend who made us meet said that I'm writing this book, and he went very quiet. And when the meeting ended, he just looked at me and he said, "I'm sorry," and he left. So I don't know what he was sorry for. I mean, maybe he was sorry for his father. But yes, I spoke to a gentleman called Kanti Ganguly, who was a minister in the Jyotibasu government. That's also a chapter, who was the only leftist leader at that time who allowed me to speak. And you can read, I mean, he's denied most of it. He also says less than 10 people died. And he said that how can you even think that we would do this to lower caste refugees? You know, we don't believe in caste.
I just want to know, this is a very fantastic topic you have taken up, but while you were doing your research and speaking to people, did you actually get into the archival documented records of the government at any place that you can find to sort of authenticate and sort of to come to a more concrete conclusion as to what was the numbers and who gave the orders for the police, who gave the orders to have that barricade,
there were to and fro letters. I have gone through that. Those have been documented also in Bengal. Bengali books. This is not the first book on Marichjhapi, but this is the first time it has been mainstream, because those books have gone out of publication for some reason. So those letters have been published, and though, like I said, it was so far away that I think the Bengali press at that time was forced to, and also lost interest, you know, to record it. Sorry? They were forced, yes. Sort of, yes. But there's one gentleman who I spoke to. No, there were no written orders. No, there's no archival history. There are no written orders. I'll tell you something horrific. Since it's recorded history, and I have also not mentioned that. When they were getting impatient that this island has to be now freed of refugees, we can't let these people stay, they thought that somebody told somebody in the government that, you know, you should let out Muslim gangs, quote unquote, because they will because they hate these people, and they will unleash atrocities on Hindu refugees to an extent that even the police can't. So apparently it's not just the police who went in to massacre, it was also the Muslim gangs. So I heard it from one survivor. I decided to sort of, you know, keep that bit out. But there is no order. It was an unofficial order. It was a decision that was taken. Somebody said that, you know, don't just let in the police. Let sort of Muslim gangs also go into the island and let them do what they want to do. Because perhaps even the police would stop somewhere. But these people won't. So hardened criminals were let out to go into the island and torture these refugees to force them to get out.
Said about, you know, you sort of let loose Muslims on those people so that they will kill them.
Yes.
So I think we need to modify what Marx had said about religion, opiate of the masses.
Yes.
It should be called the opiate of the politicians now.
Yes, yes.
You should mention this in your book somewhere.
Yes.
Congratulations on your book.
Thank you.
There are many few books written on the plight of East Bengali refugees.
Yes.
One is written by Tathagat Rai.
Yes.
Right. I believe that your book, what does it, it exposes the hypocrisy of the left.
Yes.
You know, they have the time to take out rallies for what is happening in Palestine.
Yes.
But they do not have the time to look across the border what is happening there.
Yes.
Right. So my question is, Jyoti Basu, who is the longest serving chief minister of West Bengal, I guess 34 years, his family hails from a place called Narayanganj in East Bengal.
Yes, that's true.
Right.
Yeah.
So why couldn't he understand the pain of those people? And the second question is, the plight of Sri Lankan Tamils is a very big political issue in Tamil Nadu, and it is, you know, carried on by DMK.
Yeah.
Why couldn't that happen in West Bengal? Why people have forgot everything?
So
I believe so.
Answer to the second question first. The people who were meant to speak up for these refugees were the ones who did this massacre. So it was the left who spoke up for these refugees. When the Congress government, when these guys were coming in, the Congress government decided to send them to Dandakaran. It's the left that stood up and said, no, they're Bengali refugees. They speak the Bengali language. They understand the land, the rivers. They should be rehabilitated here. So they were the voice of the refugees. So it's betrayal from one of your own. They stood up for the refugees, and it is they who massacred them.
So actually, my question is twofold. So would you like to tell me, like, when they were sent to Dandakan, like just after the partition, was it?
No. Partition, like I said, during the partition from East Pakistan, later became Bangladesh. The first group of refugees who came, Hindu refugees who came this side to West Bengal, were the upper caste Hindus. The lower caste Hindus decided to stay back, you know, because they were very attached to the land. They were tillers or they were fishermen, and they thought that they are the victims of the victims of caste, and in that they were similar to the Muslims, who because of their religion were also kept aside by the upper caste Hindus. So they thought, these are brothers, I mean, we have both suffered, so in this new land we will be together, nothing will happen. But when India became free, and, you know, East Pakistan sort of became another country, that was not what what happened. What happened was they started viewing them as Hindus, not as sort of subalterns who were together once in their struggle. So the riots continued. So 50s, 60s, right to the 70s, migration waves came, and these migration waves were mostly of lower caste Hindus.
So the statement of the left that these are Bengalis, so you shouldn't shift them to Madhya Pradesh or somewhere. So that came in the 60s maybe?
Yes, that came in the 50s also. I mean, when they were coming in and this, it was decided to shift them to Thandakaran, the left leader stood up and they said that they held, not just stood up, they sort of held sabhas, you know, where they said, no, this can't happen. We have to sort of... That was a vote bank.
In fact, the Bangladesh creation was one of the immigrants who came from Bangladesh. 85% were Hindus.
Yes. Yet it is always hidden as a fact that it was not exactly a Hindu massacre. It's a forgotten Hindu massacre. But that was what actually led to it. It's like mentioned in this book, the Blood Telegram.
Yes.
So the majority were Hindus. We call it Bengalis, and Pakistan wreaked havoc on Bengalis. But yes, in reality, they were Bengali Hindus. And it is believed 80-85% were Hindus.
Yes.
Those who were in favor of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, asking for a separate state for Bengalis, and which eventually led to, you know, Indira Gandhi giving the orders for the fight, and which led to, again, it's not portrayed in that manner. We all know that, you know, okay, Bangladesh was created, there was a war, but the reality is that which is again, you know, hidden from the masses. Because,
you know, interestingly, Mohammad Salim was a very prominent left leader, CPM leader. He wrote on Twitter after my book came out that this is propaganda. But he also mentioned, it's very funny, in one sentence he said Marichjhapi massacre is a propaganda. Now if it's a massacre, it can't be a propaganda. You can, I mean, either it's a massacre or it's a propaganda. But he said Marichjhapi massacre is a propaganda. It's very interesting. Also, some of the Facebook comments when I wrote about the book, or sort of put out pictures of sort of the launch and etc. There's a gentleman, leftist historian, who said that, you know, why are you saying it's a Hindu massacre? So I asked him, are Dalits not Hindus? To which he had no answer. So, yeah, it's very interesting. So he said, it's not a Hindu massacre, it's a Dalit massacre. So I asked him that, he had no answer though.
As a supplementary to the gentleman who asked about the sympathy of people from Tamil Nadu to the people, and it's more of, I'm talking more about Bengali ethos. There is still a lot of affection, sentiments for the people who have gone out of Tamil Nadu probably 100 years back, 150 years back. How is it that the Bengalis, who are so very, staunchly in connection with their language and their culture, how is it that they are not projecting the problems of refugees in of people in Bengal, in Bangladesh?
It can happen in Tamil Nadu.
Please, ma'am. I will quote Mr. Vivek Debroy, who I believe is going to address this gathering today later on. In the first talk on Blood Island, he said that this is a shame for not just the left front but the entire Bengali community, because it's not as if Bengalis were not sympathetic to refugees. You know, though there was a division, but the Ghotis and the Bangals in Bengal, we call them. The Bangals were those who came from the other side, who came as refugees. But like I said, the first wave of migration that happened were the upper caste refugees, and they settled in and around Kolkata. You know, the entire history of South Kolkata, if you go to Kolkata today, I mean, talk to them, most of them are refugees, were refugees, their parents were, or grandparents were. I stay in a place in South Kolkata where sort of, and we had sort of the hardship, but not such hardship. And we were accepted and we could set shop. But it's a shame for Bengalis, and it again reinforces the theory I don't fully completely buy, which is that this happened because they were lower caste. So it is not about not feeling empathetic towards Bengali refugees or Bengalis from the other side. It's also about the fact that they were Dalits. They were not people like us. You know, they were sort of uneducated. They were tillers of lands. They were fishermen. So you could perhaps not care for them the way you cared for the Bhadralok. So it's like it's a shame for Bengalis.
This blindsiding of Bangladeshi Hindus and the problem they are facing today, and the fact is that they are still trying to migrate to India.
Yes.
And how is it still not being looked at with that passion which a normal Bengali should look at?
Well, migration is, as we speak, I think migration is happening, because parts of the border, Bengal's border with Bangladesh is porous. So, I mean, if you examine Bengal politics closely, CPM's politics and Trinamool's, I mean, you'd see that a lot of people are still coming in. But I think, sadly, it's more vote bank politics. It's not really so welcoming for Hindus. So, I think a lot of people are allowed to come in with an idea to convert them into vote banks. So sympathy lies somewhere else because of political reasons.
Adding to that, you know, during 1947, when the partition happened, there was a person by the name of Joginderanath Mandal.
Yes, yes.
Right.
Yes.
He told that those Dalits, or they are also called as Namashudras.
Namashudras.
Yes. He was also among them. He assured them that, you know, if you stay with Pakistan, I will protect your interests.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
But that did not actually happen.
That didn't happen.
And when you say, yes, I agree to the fact, up to 1960s, those people who were, you know, intelligent enough, they understood the situation and they came here.
Yes.
Right. But when Bangladesh was formed in 1971 and after Mujib's death,
yes,
when Ziaur Rahman and the BNP came, the situation became unbearable.
Yes.
That wave of Bangladeshi nationalisms, you know, swept, and for them it was, living there was not possible.
Yes.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
So the issue that you are talking about is kind of pro-right. But
no, it's not pro-right. It's just pro-humanity. It's not, yes, pro-right,
it
at all.
It's pro-humanity, but
it's massacre. Against the, it's not left-right. I can't not talk against the left because they killed people. So I have to talk against the left, but it's not pro-right.
Yeah, I mean, the left would not like this issue to be
highlighted
up. Yes.
Yes.
So I have a perception that India Today Group is kind of pro-left.
Pro-left?
Yes.
I don't think that's true.
And because of how Rahul Kamal frames his questions.
No, I mean, this has nothing to do with India Today. So please keep
my
India Today questions out. Incidentally, when I started writing the book, there was UPA government.
Mm-hmm.
When I finished, it took me 5 years to write the book. When I completed the book, Mr. Modi was in power. I was not in India Today when the book started. So, I mean, those things have nothing to do with the book. It's just I know the story. Because, you know, I'm invested in the story. I heard the story as a five-year-old. My father had tried to help, do his best to help the refugees. I know down the years, I've met many people who are linked to the story. That's why there's a book. It's not a pro-right book. There's no pro-right, pro-left in a massacre. It's a massacre. Somebody said that, one very prominent publisher said that, can you tone down the anti-left rhetoric? So I asked the publisher, how can that happen? Because it's the left front government that killed these people. So how can I tone it down possibly? So I changed my publisher. So, But yes, on social media, a lot of people do say that it's...
Thank you so much for introducing this subject, which is unknown to my generation, like who is born after emergency.
Yeah.
So my thing is this, that to describe history, you must use the terminology or terms which are known in the, you know, like normal way.
Yeah.
But the narrative is set by terms only, like,
yes,
right and left.
Yes.
And majority and minority and Muslims and Hindus.
Yes.
But the truth remains that on a universal scale since history, you know, like anybody who has been destroyed is always weak.
Yeah.
Or the person who can be oppressed.
Yes.
It can be majority also.
Yes.
It can be left also. It can be Christians also. There can be good people in everywhere.
Yeah.
Who are working, you know, like backward and forward.
Yeah.
So like Ambedkar and this Bhim and Meme.
Yeah.
Ambedkar was made chairman and the constitution was passed with the provisions for backwards when majority were forward people.
Yeah.
So, don't you think that to fight the narrative, we must have, you know, like strong or weak or rich or poor, which are only two things, because inside a family also in Hindus, we always have this pariha attitude towards a brother who is not so well learning. I know.
You know what, I think the one of the good things now, a lot of bad things, one of the good things now is everybody's got a voice, you know. So the more people speak, the more different kinds of people speak, I think the narratives would get corrected. Previously, only the powerful spoke. Now, a lot of people can speak. Anybody can have a Facebook account. Anybody can be on Twitter. anybody can send something on WhatsApp. There are problems there, but it is also a hugely democratic force. You can't shut people out anymore. Misinformation spreads, yes, but also you can't today perhaps have an incident like Marichjhapi. At that time, the press could be forced to shut up. At that time, the few books that came out could be taken off the shelves. At that time, there was no social media, there was no TV, right? TV was there, Doordarshan, but it was sort of not TV as we know it in India today. But yes, there was no TV, no TV in the way we know it. But now it's not possible. So what you are asking, that now I think it's easier to correct a narrative. If somebody is saying something, you know, there can be a counter view which can be easily put forth.